Today we're going to look at an absolutely fantastic solution to help speed up the installation of EV charge points in car parks. Now, the keen-eyed amongst you will recognise this. It's the EASEE EV charger, and we've done some videos on this in the past. Check out those if you haven't seen them to get up to speed about what we're going to talk about today. But we've paired it with this flat cable system from Woertz. Now, it's Swiss made, but it's brought into the country by IDACS, who've partnered with EASEE to help develop this solution to make your life easier. But Gary, what problem are we trying to solve here?
So let's imagine there's 100 apartments in the block, and each of those apartments have an underground parking space allocated to them. And of those 100 apartments, 10 of them have adopted EV, therefore require an EASEE EV charging point within their bay. What's going to happen over time, Gordon?
Okay, so more and more people are going to adopt EV because, yes, we'll get rid of petrol and diesel cars and stop selling them. But as a property owner, property developer, you're going to have to provide the facility so people can charge at home, because that's where most charging takes place.
And we saw in our previous video how we looped in and looped out our EASEE EV charging points. However, that means the initial infrastructure needs to be in, so all cabling, even if you put the dummy EASEE EV charging point in. What's the advantage of this system?
Okay, so this system allows you to flexibly be able to deploy those EV chargers, because what we've got here is this flat cable. Best way to think of that is just like a bus bar. You run it round the car park, and then you add these tap-off points which go down to the EV chargers as and when you need to. So, you know, possibly delaying some of that initial investment, but being quick when it comes to somebody needing a charge point adding as they get an EV.
We've installed this installation behind us. Let's go through the key parts that we've installed. So here we are at the mimicked origin of our installation, where we pick up our supply. And from here, we've wired three-phase neutral and protective conductor in 16mm squared tri-rated cables through our flexi conduit into our junction box here. The connections are made in here, but the clever part of it is how we connect from the junction box onto the bus bar. It's screwed in, therefore we don't need to strip and terminate our bus bar in order to make our connections. We've got an end cap here. Later on in the presentation, we'll show you how to connect that up. Remember, the EASEE EV chargers are really clever. They will never exceed the incoming supply fuse and will cleverly communicate between each other, so they share the load throughout the system. Let's have a look at one of those EV charging points next.
So to connect to the EASEE EV charger, it's the same process but in reverse. So we've got our branching box here, again, is screwed onto the bus bar cable, and we've come out of that with this tough sheath cable down to our EASEE charging point. Let's just remind ourselves what's under the cover. You remove this Star Wars inspired front cover and you'll find inside this charging berry. And again, they just latch into place. That's how easy it was. So now, earlier video, you would have seen us connect into this charging module. So let's have a closer look at the system components that make up this bus bar distribution system.
We've got an array of items to look at here on the table. Where would you like to start?
Well, let's start with a cable, Gary, because it looks absolutely gorgeous when it's cut properly.
Okay, bring in hand cam, and yes, you're absolutely right, it's lovely, isn't it?
Yes, see our conductors there. Now, at first, we were a bit concerned. Obviously, they look incredibly close together. Remember, this is XLPE insulation, so it tends to be slightly thinner than you would expect on PVC, but the key to the system is this end connector, which you're going to come onto later, showing you how to fit that. So, the other bit that works fine with, obviously, is the branching box. Again, you're going to show us how to fit, but let's have a look at that, how that works. So again, cable has a polarity to it, that when you marry it up with this box, you'll see matches the profile of the box itself.
Yeah, so you've got to get it right way around, yeah, in order to offer it into there. What's next?
So let's have a closer look at the box. If I open up the box, you'll see there's a gasket seal there.
And does that seal against the cable itself?
Yeah, so that seals against the cable, and obviously these two screws here in this in the plastic component secures the two halves together to clamp it into place. And then to connect our cable, we've got these screw connectors here marked by the red tab.
Okay, so
if I start screwing one of them on this side, so I'll start turning it there.
Yeah.
Turn the box over, you'll start to see that appear through the back.
Oh yeah, so you've got that point coming through which punches into the conductor itself.
Yeah, now obviously you're going to worry that that's going to carry on going and going and going. Nearly there. It doesn't, so it'll stop in a moment.
Okay.
Yeah, so that's as far as I can go. And obviously if I clap that shut, you can still see there's a significant amount of clearance between the screw
and obviously the metal surface at the back.
Okay, yeah. And that means that we don't have to strip back, obviously, the bus bar in order to make the electrical connections, just screwed straight into the conductors, isn't it?
Yeah, that's it. And one thing we did find important, yes, obviously make sure you have got the right type of screwdriver bit. This is a Phillips 2. If you don't have the right sort of bit, you're going to need to put an incredible amount of torque into there.
Yeah.
And it would just slip out and damage the screw thread. Also got these nice cage clamp terminals. Again, so when we put our conductors in there, we're not going to damage them with any screws or anything.
And as this is a branching box, that'll be 2 6mm cables if you wanted to put two in there, yeah?
Yeah, and again, there's two exit points at either end of the box.
Okay, so we had to strip the ends of the cables to look like this. Shall we see that footage next?
Yeah, let's have a look at that.
So I can fit the end piece. I'm going to need to mark in from the end of the cable 19mm and mark all the way around it. Is there a specialist tool I can get to strip this cable?
There is. If you're fitting a lot of the system, there's a special tool, but we didn't get that for you, Gary, because we know you love a knife.
Okay, so I'll mark all the way around. I'm going to stick my gloves on and I'm going to take my knife. I'm going to press really quite firmly in order to cut into the cable itself. What type of material is it made of, Gordon?
So it's quite a tough outer sheath and it's LSOH, so there's no problems with fumes in a fire situation. And yep, you're just getting enough there, Gary.
Yeah, so I'm going to cut it down here, and then when I do actually start peeling it away, it's very easy in order to peel it away. So just a couple of strikes with my knife. Look how easy that is to peel away once you get it going. But there is, like you said, a specialist tool for it as well. The conductors themselves, what insulation is around them?
Yeah, so they're XLPE, so again, similar to what we'd expect to see in most armoured cables that we're used to installing.
Okay, and we've got our three lines, neutral and protective conductor there. Now we're going to fit our end piece. It has got an angled section and a straight section. You must make sure you get it the right way round. And you can see straight away, I can't get it all the way on, Gordon.
No, so you're going to have to just spread those conductors out slightly so they just drop into the grooves which are there to obviously give us the required creepage and clearance distance between the conductors.
Yeah, so just open them out and you'll see now it slides all the way on. It's just a case now of tightening these two screws either side in order to lock the end piece into position.
Yeah, and that also gives us the IP65 rating which is on this system.
Yeah, there you go, firmly on.
Well, Gary, even with your knife skills, that's probably the most difficult part about the entire installation of this system.
And it wasn't difficult in order to strip the end. However, we've been bouncing ideas around. What things do we think we should be considering?
So obviously, you know, probably thinking, well, current carrying capacity, things like that, yeah, on this system. Car parks, you're probably quite long cable lengths, especially, you know, with the EASEE. You can put 100 chargers on a system. We think it's probably going to be voltage drop that limits the application. But obviously put your thoughts below and any other regulation related questions, because I think we need to look in detail at just how good a continuity we can get between those, yeah, screw connectors and the bus bar cable, and possibly the insulation resistance as well.
Absolutely. Can you give me any other applications where this can be used?
Okay, so IDACS are bringing this into the UK. It is used in, we believe, in hotel applications. So possibly thinking, run this down the corridor and then, yeah, branching off to rooms on either side of the corridor, and that's a great application for it.
We looked into it and meets a lot of standards and can even be used on ships. Is that right, Gordon?
Yeah, it is. Yeah, so it's got marine approvals, and just don't think, you know, Switzerland, not a country renowned for taking risks. Think of precision, and yeah, this is a well-engineered product.
I think we've teased it for long enough. Shall we see the install now? So I'm going to fix the flat cable bow to the structure of the building using these clips. They have no polarity to them, so there's no angled groove and straight edge. It doesn't matter which way around it goes.
Yeah, and obviously steel clips, so they're suitable for any premature collapse requirements that may be tied to the installation.
Along with the appropriate fixing, you can see we're fixing it to obviously a wooden surface here. But yep, so the fixings are in place, ever so simple to do. Yeah, nothing difficult about that. Before next, we're going to fit the branching box.
Yeah, now you may, if this was an existing cable install, you may have to remove a few clips to be able to just fit this behind the flat cable.
And it has a polarity, so you can see the angled edge there on the right-hand side has to be in the appropriate place, and two fixing screws in order to secure it to the structure of the building.
Yeah, so the first edge is, yeah, fix the plate to the wall before we think about fitting the actual connector itself.
Okay, so branching box, screw it back to the surface, and then we've got a couple of other screws. You can see it's just not fixed to the plate at the minute, so we're going to need to screw those down with the required torque setting. So let's get the branching box fixed, like so, and then we can concentrate on two more screws before we penetrate the actual cable. So 2 Newton meters of torque now for these two screws here, Gordon.
Yeah, so these again, that we're not actually putting the conductors into the cable yet. This is just to fix the clamp around the cable and get the appropriate IP rating. So again, this is IP65.
See, it's nicely sealed there against the cable. So now we can look at screwing down onto the actual conductors. Torque settings are here.
Yeah. So again, it's 3.7 newton meters. So again, that's quite a beefy torque setting. But again, we've got to get into that XLPE conductor right in the middle of the cable.
So yeah, all of these need to be screwed down. So torque them down to the required torque setting. And this means now we're making the electrical connections. And that, we saw that on the bench. That's what's happening now. So 3.7 I set it to. We'll just make these connections. And then we can think about dressing our cable in. So we've got a D-line clip here. Again, a metallic clip and screw to secure the cable. What type of cable are we going to use?
So again, we're going to use a high tough cable as well, similar to NYY, but this has an XLPE conductor to match the flat cable we're using in this installation.
Okay, so round we go, secure those in, and then we can make the end off into the branching box. And again, we've got the lengths of the conductors now, Gordon. So we've got 220 for two of the conductors and 150 for the other three.
Yeah, no, you probably would have, in hindsight, made them a bit longer, wouldn't you, Gary?
Always follow the instructions, especially the first time. So this is 220. So yeah, I'm going to cut it at 220 just to get that feel for actually the length. Yeah, I probably would have gone a fraction longer, but it fits perfectly. You'll see in a minute when I actually finish the terminations. I'm going to cut them to length using my Preki stripper.
But this is, of course, a Swiss product, so all down for precision, but they may have been using a different cable to the type we've selected here. So obviously that's the, could be account for the different lengths.
Yeah, I think a tri-rated cable might have been a little bit easier to swing in, but it swings in perfectly. So they're cut to length. Now I'm going to connect the other three to the same length of 150 millimetres. Yep. So it's there on the actual enclosure. You can see it, 150 mil for the other three. So once I've got those to length, I can obviously make the terminations. I'm going to go in via the stuffing gland on the left-hand side. Could I come in from the right-hand side, Gordon?
You could have done. So this is a branching box, and yeah, you can have two cables up to 6 millimeter conductor area. So obviously you can feed two charge points. We're only doing one in this trial installation. Yeah. And there's lengths even for those mentioned in the lid as well.
There is. So yeah, I'll complete all of them. And now I look to make my terminations. I've made all but one to go. So I've got the distance there for the insulation to be removed of 16 millimeters in order to put it in. Again, I set my Preki stripper to 16 mil to remove the cross-linked polyethylene around the actual conductors. And then I set my torque screwdriver, Gordon.
Yeah, back to 2 newton meters for these for the electrical connections to the outgoing cables.
And what's the head on this screwdriver?
They're all Phillips 2 head on this across the whole, all of the screws that you need to make those connections and to the flat cable itself.
Yeah, I like that. Yeah, absolutely. One screwdriver for everything, which is really nice. I've dressed them in, so now needs the lid to be returned. We've got this bung on the end.
Yeah, because again, we're just using, it's a branching box, but we're only using one one cable way out. And we'll just blank that off of that all-important O-ring to keep the required IP rating.
And we'll see again, there is a seal on the lid itself as well for that IP rating. So I'm going to bring the lid in next. So just see here, Gordon, there you go.
Yeah. And a good thing here, captive screws on this branching box lid as well, so we've got no worries about losing the screws.
And the torque setting for these ones?
Again, 2 newton meters on these, and again, labelled inside there, so there's no question about losing the torque settings should you need to open this for any future testing.
Yeah, or maintenance, yeah, like that. So that's the lid on. So, yeah, there we go, just to confirm, yeah, 2 newton meters of torque for that.
And it's a similar approach. So this is our junction box to bring in the incoming cable. And we've selected a 16 millimeter tri-rated cable here. It's multi-stranded, so we're just adding a ferrule just to give that a suitable treatment before putting them into the cage clamps.
And we chose the largest cable size it could do. Again, we're just testing the process, aren't we here, Gordon? So we went for 16 millimeter squared cable.
Yeah, and we brought that in with a flexible conduit, 40 millimeter flexible conduit. It's an M40 hole into this junction box. So again, I don't think you'd be able to bring an armoured cable in here and suitably terminate it.
And you can only come in from one side on this one, can't you?
That's right.
So that's that. Just have a quick look at the finished eFIXX EV charging point. I think we're ready to go live.
So Gary, what's your thoughts about that installation?
I thought it was easy. I enjoyed every element from start to finish of that system.
Yeah, that's not often you hear that from Gary. There's always something he likes to have a complaint about, but what's your thoughts? You know, are you installing the eFIXX EV chargers already? Are you looking forward to marrying them together with this fantastic cabling system from Woertz? Share those thoughts below. Obviously help other installers out there who are getting into the EV market with possibly some things we've missed on the system and some of the tips you might like to share with them.
We'll get back to as many of those comments as we can.